Jamal's roommate, Amir, is the most likely suspect.
He has an alibi. Praying.
Yes, but he was alone.
What about the other roommate? Tariq.
We can't find any contact between Tariq and the victim, and he doesn't have the political motive. Amir is the Palestinian hardliner. Tariq could care less.
Okay. Thank you, Alicia.
Hi, everybody. I'm Peter Travers. This is Popcorn. And today's guest is Julianna Margulies, the fresh new winner of Best Lead Actress in a Drama Series for The Good Wife. And did they ever get that right? They got it right.
Thank you very much.
So here you are, fresh from all that. So how does it feel? Victory.
It feels lovely. It really feels good. It was a very challenging year last year, and I loved the storyline, and I put my heart and soul into it. So to be recognized for that is a really big honor to me.
Yeah, but come on, when you win it, when you go back on the set, is there a whole different thing going on, you know, where you just say, excuse me,
no.
I'm not ready now.
No, I've never been like that. It was very sweet.
What a shame. That's just so sad. I would like you to be wielding that thing.
I know a few people like that. And I don't want them at my house for dinner.
They're not coming, no.
But no, I mean, they were very sweet because they all felt, the biggest thing for me was everyone on the set and my producers all said it felt like our win. And so for me, that was the best, as knowing that they were all right there with me.
6 months in county, 1 year probation.
No.
I'll see you in court.
Tell Peter there has to be a better way to firm up his campaign contributions.
Using everything we can, are we?
Tell us some secrets.
About the show?
Yeah, I want to know a little bit. I mean, you know, that season two ended. We were up in the air in a lot of ways.
Right.
And I know you're not going to tell me anything, but...
I can tell you some things.
Some things, yeah.
Well, first of all, what I love about this season, they've brought in a lot more of the political aspect of the show, which... You know, I was talking about it with Alan Cumming, who is the political side of the show now.
Eli Gold,
and his character is in our offices. And in the new season, you have my office and his office. We can see each other. So it's like he's always got his thumb on me.
Ooh.
It's fabulous, because as much as my character's trying to break away from her husband, the truth is his success is her success now. Because people will want her if her husband is the state's attorney, and now he's probably going to be running for governorship. So it's a very slippery slope for how she's going to handle herself. She's been horribly betrayed, and I think she's taking a little bit more of the dark side. But underneath it all, she is a good girl. That's the title of the show. Underneath everything, she first and foremost protects her children. So it's really interesting to watch this juxtaposition.
Well, they could have called it The Good Mother if it was only about the children.
Well, they could have, and it's not.
It's not.
I think she just grew up into herself.
Mm-hmm.
And so being the good wife, being the good mother, being this good person hasn't gotten her very far. So she's going to try something else. But I think it's going to be this constant pull to going back, this guilt to feeling like, aren't I supposed to be the good girl?
It's just my neighbors.
So what's this day like for you then, when you're getting up on a work day? When does it start?
My work day usually starts, if it was a Monday, it would start at 5 a.m. I'd get up. I would get to the studio by 6, hair and makeup, script in hand, rehearse, go get dressed, come while they light, come down, and I'm there until probably 9 o'clock at night.
It makes me ask the question about your poor husband, you know?
No,
talk about
that.
The good wife, you know?
I think it's really important to say no to a lot of things so I can be home when I'm free. I find it very calming to know that my weekend will just be with my family. And I really try and make a balance of that. And on my hiatus, I didn't work. I just stayed home and took care of my son and was trying to be a good wife.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a good balance. I also know this isn't long-lived, you know? I've done a series before.
Oh, that ER, how long did that last?
Yeah. Well,
but you, right.
Well, I was on it for six years.
Six years, yeah.
I think it lasted 15, if I'm correct. That's amazing. So I'm trying to enjoy it while I can. It's a very different experience this time around because I'm so settled in my home life that all the little things that used to get me on ER, also I was in my, you know, I started ER, I was 26 years old.
So it's different, and I know what I'm in for now, and I just enjoy it. You know, when I hear people complain, I always think, it beats slinging hash or serving a drink, you know, and let's...
But were you ever doing that, Julianna?
Yes.
Were you?
Absolutely.
Were
you really? I was a co-check girl.
You were
I was
Sarah
a waitress.
Lawrence girl.
I was Sarah Lawrence girl. I know.
Doesn't happen.
They've just asked me to teach a master class in their spring semester, and I'm in an absolute panic because part of me is so excited to do it, and the other part thinks I'm not worthy to... teach
a master
yet,
class.
But I'm master class.
What do you wear for the master class day? I just wonder what is.
Well, but I do think I, you know, it's funny because when I was talking it over with my husband, he had taught a course at Dartmouth on Mozart. He's a big Mozart fan. And he said, you will get more out of teaching that class for that one day than you'll get out of, you know, a year of acting. So I thought, that's a great way to, I'm going to do it then. I'm going to bite the bullet and do it. I always say, if you're in it for fame, get out, because you'll always disappoint and you're not in it for the right reasons.
Now, I know you said you were at the library, but the time code on that traffic light shows that the driver of your car was running a red light just outside the campus gates at the exact moment of the interfaith rally. That means that the driver of your car, if that is you, couldn't have been involved in the rally fight. Do you understand?
I do.
So I want you to take your time before you answer. Is that you driving your car?
So now, when you graduated from Sarah Lawrence and got involved in the theater, what was that goal? What were you looking to do?
You know, I graduated Sarah Lawrence and said to myself, I had a plan.
I'm going to sling hash. Yeah, that's what
I said, I'm going to do this until I'm 25. I was 21. I'm going to do this until I'm 25. If I haven't been able to make my insurance and make a decent living just to pay my rent through acting, that will be a sign that I'm not good enough. And I will go back to school either. I was interested in law, actually, funnily enough, or psychiatry. I thought that would be interesting, some sort of psychology.
But not nursing.
Psychiatry.
Yeah.
No, not nursing. Nothing in the medical. That's too beyond me. And I thought, okay, you've got 4 years to do this. And if it doesn't happen, get out. You're not welcome. Because I didn't want to spend my life being rejected and feeling like I wasn't living my dream. So I started waitressing, but I was always the kind of, if I'm going to waitress, it's going to be at the best restaurant, so I'm making the most money.
Yeah, good,
you know,
tips.
Good tips. Mm-hmm. And I walked into a restaurant in Soho that I actually live around the corner from. It's hysterical now because I walk by it and I can't believe that's where I, you know, slung hash. And I said, I need a job. And they said, okay. Turned out to be an amazing job where, you know, I was waitressing on every celebrity there was at the time. And it was fun and it was dress up and hard work, but great. Mm-hmm. And 6 months later, I got my first movie. And then I got a commercial. And then I got
Was that the Steven Seagal?
Steven Seagal.
Out for Justice.
Sorry, God.
But so I guess you're watching that every night.
It got me in the
That's
union.
That's always on your Netflix queue. Yeah, right. Mm-hmm.
It got me in the union. It got me a great agent. Next thing I knew, I was doing off-Broadway. Then I was doing a lot of regional theater. And I did one Law & Order, and NBC saw me and had me come and audition for ER. And it sort of,
It's a nice one because everybody that does get a good waitressing job does get a Law & Order with it.
Any New York actor
that's it. It's
will
just,
have
it
a
goes
order.
Right with that. Too.
It's true.
Yeah.
But I do remember like going out to LA for this first movie role and thinking, well, that's it. I don't have to waitress anymore. I came back to New York and, you know, 6 months later, regional theater doesn't really pay your rent. I was bartending and it was a good humble, I ate some humble pie and I thought, oh right, this is a process.
Yeah, bartending sounds like good experience.
It was great.
For all of this.
Much better than waitressing because everyone wants a drink so they're nice to you.
Yeah, they want that right away and then they're going to talk, right?
And there's
a bar,
no one can touch you, which I liked.
Yeah, protected,
yeah.
All of that.
But
you've never played
a bartender. I was an awful, I'd like shake a margarita and then like be like, here, I think, but you know.
Well, I would love to be a fly on the wall at the master class because I would like to know what the first thing is you would say to a group of young people that want to do this. What? Because when they come up to you, what do they say? What do they say? How do I get a job? How do I get your job?
Most
what do they
young
want to
people
know?
Ask how to get into the business. And I always say that should never be your first question. Your first question should be, what's the best acting class I can take? Who are the best actors to watch? How can I get better at my craft? We live in a very tricky society now where fame seems to be more important than craft. And I know it sounds corny, but it breaks my heart. I think craft in the end will win out, but fame seems to be, I always say if you're in it for fame, get out, because you'll always disappoint and you're not in it for the right reasons.
What's up with you anyway? You seem different. Where are you going?
Court.
Why?
I'm a lawyer.
Okay.
Looking back on every episode you've done, is there a moment, even 30 seconds, that sticks with you where you're looking at you, not the show, not anything else but you, where you can look at you and say, I'm satisfied with that?
There's been a couple, but the...
I'm only asking for one, Julianna.
It was the pilot.
Yeah.
In the pilot, when she slaps him in the hallway, when they've come from the podium and she slaps him in the hallway, I kept reading it as her feeling so small, like so out of control and so small that the only thing she could do in that moment was hit him, and it was so not her character. And I wanted so much to convey her complete disgust with herself and him in that moment. And when I saw the pilot and the way you see, they pull the camera back and she's just standing there by herself in this good wife outfit with the pearls, and you just sort of see her shaking. For me, when I saw the pilot, I went, oh, thank God. And actually the director, Charles McDougall, wrote an email to me after we shot that day. It was a very long day. It was an 18-hour day. And he said, it's rare as a director that you envision a scene and it comes out exactly as you envisioned it.
I wanted to just ask a little bit about movies because you know how much I love City Island.
Thank you.
And that was a performance that is 180 degrees from Alicia Florek.
I loved that character.
You and Andy Garcia. And what, I still remember you sitting there saying when he's asking you to make something special for dinner.
Hey, you want balloons or something? It's my favorite.
It's always special. It's always special. You're doing that accent.
Right.
And then A Man from the Elysian Fields, where I think every decade you should make another movie with Mick Jagger.
Oh, I think so,
I think it's really important. And he should be guesting on The Good Wife.
He was so good in Man from the Elysian Fields.
And I don't know why you don't get him to guest on that.
I think, you know, I actually had a great acting conversation with Mick Jagger.
Really?
In the trailer. Our scenes weren't together that much, but we had this overlap and we were both in the makeup trailer, and he just started asking me for acting tips. I'm easygoing, go with the flow. He left the trailer and suddenly I went, oh my God, I just came Mick Jagger action. I was flushed. My heart started pounding.
It's Mick Jagger.
He really wanted to act, like he was great. I thought he was great.
So what did you tell him, you know? Just be real?
I said, listen.
Listen.
Listen to what the other guy's saying.
Yeah.
You know, it's like tennis. If you just return it and not slam it, just return someone's good hit, you're going to hit really well. That's what
good
acting
advice.
Is.
Good advice. The mess. Well, I always end this with the same question to every guest, and it's always song.
It's a what?
It's always song. It's always asking. Maybe it's a song you sing to your son. Maybe it's something that was sung to you when you were growing up, or maybe it's a Mick Jagger song, or maybe it's in you to sing Stand By Your Man by Tammy Wynette. I don't know, but this is your moment to go out.
Oh, really?
Yes.
Well, I have to say, lately, I've taught my son this song because I think it's such a fantastic song. And it says so much about human nature. You say tomato, and I say tomato. You say potato, and you say... Do I have to sing the whole thing?
Just a little bit to end it.
Oh, really? Okay.
Yeah.
Well, my favorite part of the song is I'm hoarse, though. That's so sad.
That sounds sexier, really.
Really?
Yeah, take it from
me. But, oh, if we call the whole thing off, then we must part. And, oh, if we ever part, that would break my heart. So you say pajama, and I say pajama. You say banana, and I say banana. Banana, banana, pajama, pajama. Let's call the calling off.
beautiful.
Let's call the calling off of.
And then he goes to sleep.
And he loves
and
it.
Everybody's happy.
We sing it together, and it's my favorite song with him.
That's delightful. Thank you, Julianna.
Thank you so much.